Welcome to Applied Mathematical Finance, Computational Finance and its Object-Oriented Implementation. And in this session and maybe in the next session, we will start talking about object-oriented implementation because today I would like to start thinking about how we will implement a numerical approximation of our model. So our model is our term structure model. So we are in the section on interest rate models, and we defined a discrete forward rate term structure model. So that means we started here with some tenor discretization, so some time discretization of maturities. So where, for example, zero coupon bonds pay, or the period discretization of here our forward rate. So we have a forward rate here, which we model. So we get a vector of forward rates where each element is then a stochastic process. So a complicated high dimensional model. And that was here our model specification, or say it is one possible way of specifying the model. So we have ETO stochastic processes with here a local volatility function. And in this formulation, so we had the local volatility function there, and we also modeled the Brownian motions. So here's the Brownian increment is having an instantaneous correlation parameter. I mentioned that that is one possible way of writing down the model because we saw in the section on efficient implementation of the drift that maybe another formulation or another specification of the model is a bit better in terms of implementation efficiency. So speaking of the drift, what was the drift? First of all, we moved to an equivalent martingale measure, and now depending on which numerator we choose, there are different possible choices. So here is the numerator for the spot measure or the spot numerator. So our reinvestment strategy always invest here in the next zero coupon bond that is on your time discretization. And choosing the numerator defines the measure, and that by Gazanov defines the drift. So here under spot measure, we then found the drift like that. So now the drift is here a function of our covariance structure. So a function of these model parameters. So this is here our local volatility function and our correlation function. We also derived another drift under another measure, the terminal measure. So we have some choice, and we can analyze this later once we have an implementation at hand. We then discussed the efficient implementation of this drift term. And while the drift is order n squared, we found that if we write down the model in an alternative form where we have here the so-called factor loadings, lambda ik, in front of Brownian increments that are mutually independent. So I have that dui, duj is zero for I not equal j. Then if the number of these factor loadings is, say, small, the implementation or the formula of the drift is much faster, is much more efficient. So you see that the drift is, instead of order n squared, it is now order m times n. So there is dm, and here's an n, and we can write an kind of update rule, so that here it looks as if it is m times n squared, but actually, since we can use an update rule, it's an order m times n, so it's much more efficient. So long story short, we like to use this form of writing down the model with a possibly low m. M is the rank of the correlation matrix. We will discuss this, getting the correlation matrix or getting a correlation matrix with a small rank later. So that is the form I would like to use. And now I would like to discuss how do we implement this model in a computer. And to implement this model, I need several numerical methods, which some of you maybe already know from the numerical methods lecture. First, we need a time discretization. Now, time discretization refers to the simulation time of the stochastic process. The maturity of the interest rates and the interest rate periods are already discretized in this model. So here, time discretization now means the little t, so the L of little t. So the simulation time discretization that is now required. And the next step is the Monte Carlo simulation or Monte Carlo method. So we need to sample the random variables. Stochastic process evaluated at this given time is a random variable. Let me shortly recapitulate these things, time discretization, Monte Carlo simulation, maybe also then looking at the classical log normal forward rate model. And then we will discuss some implementational aspects. So which concepts, which components of our model and the numerical method should actually be encapsulated in certain classes. So which parts should be together and which parts can be separated. So given that our model is an eto-stochastic process, we may now apply numerical methods to create a Monte Carlo approximation of time discretizations of the forward rate. So the time discretization here refers to actually this parameter. So we will discuss time discretization using the Euler scheme. And this here is our model specification. So in this alternative form with the factor loadings. And when I introduced these factor loading parameter lambda I used du for the independent, dui, duj, for the independent Brownian increments. So delta uk is then the independent Brownian increment. Because before we started with a formulation where delta wk was actually a correlated Brownian increment. So we had the correlation function. But since we now always will work with this form here, I will just rename the u as the delta w. So note here important, the delta wk is now an independent Brownian increment. Huh? So we have dwi dwj is zero for I not equal j. Okay, then my model is dli is mu I dt plus lambda I dw. And the lambda I is actually a vector. So this here is a scalar product. And the dw is also a vector. So we have here this scalar product. So these are now my M vector loadings multiplied with the M independent Brownian motions, Brownian increments. Of course, there's a connection between our two formulations. So you know that the lambda k can be decomposed into a volatility function, sigma I, and some, say, vector fik, where the scalar product of the vectors fi and fj forms the covariance matrix. From the covariance. Okay, in this formulation here, all the objects can be evaluated at simulation time. So we have something like mu I of t, or we have also something like lambda I k of t, and all the objects are random variables. So the parameters here evaluated at the simulation time little t are ft measurable random variables. So I shortened a little bit the notation. So lambda I of k in the local volatility formulation could depend on L, where L is the vector actually of all Li. And I will just write lambda ik of t and just note that this is a random variable. You could also think of a stochastic volatility model where lambda ik is generated by, say, a different stochastic process. So that's my model specification. And speaking here of model parameters, okay, what are the model parameters? The model parameters are here my initial value, the specification of the factor loading, so the volatility and correlation structure, and also to some extent a little bit the mu, because that specifies under which measure we are. So there is a connection between mu and the measure, of course, because there is a connection between mu and the numerator which we choose. So qn determines mu. It's the, by the no arbitrage constraint. Well, a small additional model parameter or a small additional generalization I would like to introduce. And to motivate this, recall the classical Black-Scholes model, so a log normal process. So we have here a Black-Scholes model. So ds is rs dt plus sigma s dw. Okay, I see you have the question, isn't the drift a free parameter in the framework? Yes, yeah, it's a model parameter. You may choose the numerator as a certain model parameter, then the drift is implied by this. Yes. So that was also when I mentioned here, what are my model parameters? So what are my free parameters? The initial value, the covariance structure, and of course the numerator, which then determines the drift. Good question. If you think back of the Black-Scholes model, and if you recall doing Euler scheme for this model, then you maybe remember that it is an advantage not to discretize the model for S, but to time discretize the model for the logarithm of S. So if you move to a coordinate, y is the logarithm of S, then Itô's lemma will give you the stochastic process for y. So dy is r minus 1/2 sigma squared dt plus sigma dw. And then you see that the nice thing here is that this is a model which has constant coefficients. And that's nice because then the Euler discretization, the time discretization, will have no discretization error. So it is an advantage to maybe move to a different coordinate. And I would like to introduce this coordinate transformation also as a model parameter. Well, it will not change the model if you move to a different coordinate and write down the model under that coordinate, but it will change the discretization. And I view now the model as a specification for the discretization. And I now introduce a transformation to some state space, which I will call state space transform. So here in this example, it is the exponential function. Yeah. So s is exponential of y, so y is the logarithm of s. So and this guy, my state space transformation f here, is seen as an additional model parameter because it has an impact on the quality of the discretization, and my model is the specification of what should be discretized. So with that, I now have a generalized Euler scheme for Itô stochastic processes. Okay, given a process Y, now it's M dimensional, M factorial. Now recall M is the parameter that specifies here the dimension of this Brownian increment and the factor loading, so of this scalar product. So given an n-dimensional m factorial e2 process, dy is mu dt lambda dw, now mu and lambda written here as function of y, and some function f, an n-dimensional function mapping the n state space parameters y1 to yn to my n model parameters x1 to xn. So I define here this transformation. X is f of t and y. Then I now consider the Euler discretization of the model y. So this here is my Euler discretization. Okay, so just to recall, how do you arrive at the Euler discretization? Yeah, you just replace the infinitesimal differentials, so all the d's here, with finite differences, so with delta, so the dw becomes a delta w, the dt becomes a delta dt, and the dy becomes a delta y, but delta y is just y at the endpoint minus y at the starting point. So it's y at the endpoint minus y at the starting point, and you move that to the other side. And you have the numerical scheme for creating a time discrete approximation of our process y. So time discrete approximation, I have here a time discretization. So given a time discretization, ti, I from 0 to n, I now define that scheme. So we have here the finite differences for time and for the Brownian increment. Once I have discretized the process y, I move to my coordinate space of my, well, model primitive objects. So I move back to the space with the x. So I use here again the function f to finally arrive here at my model parameter x, x tilde now, because tilde denotes here it's just an approximation, and I only have the x at the points ti. So this here is my numerical method. So it's the Euler scheme. And what are my model parameters? What is specifying the stochastic process? So there is the initial value, of course, and now I specify here the initial value in the y coordinate. So maybe to distinguish this, I now call it initial state. Then I also specify the parameter lambda. Well, I specify the parameter lambda in the y coordinate. So the covariance structure in the y coordinate. Another model parameter is the mu, yeah, because we have the freedom to choose different numerators and we specify under which numerator we would like to simulate. And of course, another model parameter is this transformation here, because it can heavily influence the accuracy of this time discretization. So these guys here are now my model parameters. Okay, and why am I highlighting this in this way? Because this maybe gives you some intuition already how you should do your numerical implementation. Yeah, so what are maybe the parts where you cut your implementation? And one other remark here, the Brownian increment, assuming, for example, that here the initial value is a deterministic value, so a constant, and that we have here just deterministic functions, then the Brownian increment is the sole object that introduces the stochasticity. So this is the guy that is a random variable. And it's also the guy that makes all the other objects to become random variables. Yeah? You may start with a deterministic non-stochastic value, but in the first step, the next value is a random variable. So all the objects on here, the slides, the y and so on, they are random variables. So that's maybe another thing which we have to encapsulate in a certain part in the implementation. So that's now the time discretization. So that's the first step here in my discussion, the time discretization. Speaking of the random variable, the next step is the Monte Carlo simulation. So generating the sample path if we perform Monte Carlo method. Before we start with, before we go to the Monte Carlo method, here just a small table giving you some examples for this state space transformation, yeah, that may be helpful. As I already mentioned, there is, for example, here, if you think of the log normal model, so that would be if we speak of the interest rates, our Plec model, the one that we used for the caplet. So this is here, the coefficient is some Li lambda I of t, lambda I deterministic function. Then you use here the exponential function. For the normal model, our Bachelier model, we would use the identity, yeah, because there is already a constant coefficient here. And we also mentioned the displaced model. So the displaced log normal model, there we use exponential of x minus di, the displacement. So if you move the di to the other side, you have y plus di is exponential of x. So x is the logarithm of y plus di. So it means that y plus di is log normal. So the displaced, so here the y is the L. So L plus di is log normal. Okay, so now let's move to the next step. How do we create this object here, the random variable that makes all the other guys becoming random variables? So that's the Monte Carlo method. So a random variable is just on a finite space, it's just a vector. Yeah. So we have a map from some event, from some sample path, omega I to x of omega I. So I can view now the x of omega I or the sample sampled values as a vector. And that's also how we will, or how we could implement it in the computer. So if we look at a discrete sample space, then we just have that our Brownian increment. Now I have the Brownian increment at different times. And I have several factors. So I have different Brownian increments at different times. So this guy is a random variable. So it depends here on omega k. And I can now sample different realizations of this random variable. So I let k run from 0 to n minus 1. And n is here the number of sample paths. And you maybe recall that a way to generate this guy is to use the inversion of the cumulative distribution function. So I know that this guy here is normal distributed. With mean 0 and standard deviation square root of the time step size. So I have here this additional factor in front of the inversion of the cumulative distribution function of the standard normal. So this guy here is now the standard normal. Yeah, you create a normal distributed random variable by applying the inversion of the cumulative distribution function to a uniform one. So I start here with a uniform distributed random variable. So since I need such a random variable for every time step and for every factor, and every time step, every increment, and every factor are independent. So I need many of these. So I need here many, oops. So I need here many because I have many time steps. In every time step, I'm independent. And also many because I have many different factors. So here I'm counting the factors from 1 to m, yeah, because I did that also on the previous specification. So I did this also here on the specification that the factors run from 1 to m. So sometimes I'm a mathematician, then everything runs from 1 to m. Sometimes I'm a programmer, and then it runs from 0 to n minus 1. And that generates my Brownian motion, my Brownian increment. So there are two ingredients that you need here. You need an random number generator that can generate your independent uniform distributed random variables, and you need the inverse of the cumulative distribution function. For both, we have numerical implementations. Yeah, so the uij, they are uniform, they are samples of uniform random variables. Yeah, and we could use a pseudo random number generator or a quasi Monte Carlo method. Yeah, let me shortly or quickly go through the classical log normal model. So how it would look like there. So if you consider the classical log normal model, then I'm looking here at the model where DLI, so my forward rate, is some mu I, and now I write it in this log normal form because I already know the drift always has an Li inside, so I can write this log normal drift here. So actually, we had a superscript L here. So you could add here a superscript L, but maybe I can also just drop this for this slide. So mu I Li dt plus, in the other formulation, sigma I dwi, but now I use the formulation with the lambda. So it's Li times lambda I, that's the scalar product here, dw. And that's my formulation of the classical log normal model. Then you can use Itô's lemma to write down the stochastic process for logarithm of L. And you perform the Euler scheme discretization. So the next one is the Euler scheme for the logarithm. So that's here the Euler scheme discretization for the logarithm. And then you apply this state space transform. So my state space transform is f is the exponential function. So it means that L is exponential of y. So I apply here, this here is my y. Actually, my y tilde of t plus delta t and yi because I have a vector. So then I apply my state space transform and I arrive at the discretization of Li using the log Euler scheme. Yeah. So if you apply exponential here, you get, well, you get here exponential of the logarithm. That's just again the Li. Here also exponential of the logarithm. That's just the Li. Exponential of a sum becomes a product. Okay. And then you just get exponential of all this stuff here. And you see, the nice thing is that you have constant coefficients. So we have constant coefficients here. Well, at least say we have non-stochastic coefficients. Yeah? They still depend on time. And the Euler scheme makes a discretization error because the Euler scheme uses the time at the initial value of the time step. Okay, and this guy here is actually the sigma I squared. Okay, so why is that? Because my lambda I k is sigma I times the factor f I k, where, so now the F is not this state space transform, it's the F that we use to represent the correlation matrix. Yeah, there's a slight ambiguity here, but usually I only use the lambda, so there is no ambiguity. So lambda ik is the sigma I fik, where we had that the sum k from 1 to m fik fjk is the rho ik, rho ij, sorry. And now you see that this gives you that lambda I squared. Yeah, that's just sigma I squared rho ii. Yeah, so that's just sigma I squared. So that's actually the classical discretization, yeah, mu I minus 1/2 sigma squared dt. So the classical move to the log coordinates. Now, once I have this time discretization, I can look at the discretization error. if you have, for example, that the drift is zero, so let's just look at this example. So if you have that the drift is zero, well, we know that the drift is zero if we move under the corresponding forward measure. So under the measure where we choose PTI plus one as numerator, then the drift is zero. Then the mu vanishes, and I just have a discretization error depending here on this lambda parameter. And if I now replace the lambda with actually the analytic integration of lambda ik squared, so lambda ik bar is now the square root of 1 divided by delta t, the analytic integral from t to t plus delta t, lambda ik squared tau d tau. Then actually this is the exact solution. Then the scheme has no time discretization error. So that's maybe something which we also should remember for our implementation. If lambda is, for example, piecewise constant on my time discretization, piecewise constant on the time discretization, which we use here for the little t, then I have no discretization error, at least no discretization error coming from the lambda part. Yeah. So there could be a discretization error coming from the drift part, because what I have here on the slide is only valid if the drift is zero. So you still see there is here the drift at the initial time t gives you the value at the next time step t plus delta t. So there could be still a discretization error due to the drift. But if you do not look at the drift, if you just look at the diffusion part, then yeah, lambda I piecewise constant, or calculating analytically this part here, will reduce the time discretization error. Yeah, that is time discretization for the classical log normal model. Here, yeah, a little bit what I just said. Yeah, if you have piecewise constant lambda I, then the only time discretization error comes from the drift part. It is also possible to write down numerical schemes where actually the drift part does not introduce a time discretization error, because you could move to a different measure. Yeah, but yeah, actually often it's not needed. This assumption that the factor loadings are piecewise constant is not a very big assumption. Usually this assumption is made because the parameter lambda, the volatility parameter, is calibrated to options you observe on the market. And if your time discretization is very fine, there are not so many financial products that you can observe to actually calibrate the lambda in between. So actually you do not have this information what happens in between. So it's maybe okay to just assume that you take some average piecewise constant value. That was time discretization. Now next step is Monte Carlo simulation. So we just generate now our sample vectors here for the Brownian increments. Yeah, and then we are done. And you see that my model quantity, so my model object L, is now a huge or a high dimensional object. So actually I have many different interest rates at many different times and sampled for many different Monte Carlo paths. So Monte Carlo simulation paths could be 100,000. You can have 100, 200 or more simulation time steps. And if you take fine interest rate periods, you could also have some 80 interest rates. So you have 80 times 100 times 100,000. So you have a lot of numbers. once we have the model for the else, we need to generate the numerator, and that depends, of course, how we choose the numerator. If we choose the numerator in the terminal measure, it will look like that. So here we have the numerator for the terminal measure. So for the terminal measure, it was the sum from j equals I to n minus 1. So actually for the end time, so that's the zero Cooper bond observed in time ti, maturing in tn. So this is my numerator. And you also see that this is terminal measure. If you look at this point here, the product is now observed in TI, multiplying all these 1+ forward rate times period lengths over the time steps from I to n minus 1. If it would be the spot measure, we would accumulate all the interest rates over time. So actually for the spot measure, actually this here is then a parameter j, yeah, where you run over, where you fix all the rates at the beginning of their individual periods. We already had that there is a small drawback. We only know the numerator at our time discretization capital Ti. So I do not know the numerator as a stochastic process in the little t's. Yeah. So the reason is that we do not model here this short period bond. However, you can define an interpolation. So if you make an assumption, for example, the assumption that the short period bond has zero volatility, then you can do this. So which is that you model the short period bond. We will look at this later. Yeah, that was the specification of what has to be done to implement the stuff in the computer. Two steps: time discretization of the simulation time parameter, Monte Carlo method to sample the Brownian increments. Maybe we have a small break here and look at the implementation. So how we implement this in the computer, or how we cut the different parts, yeah, after the break.